Hello, everyone. Right, I'm just getting a picture to cover up many. we've had so many issues today. Has muscles. We've had a few issues today, but we're here, and I'm just picking up a picture of Hasra to slide in front of it. It looks really dark, but it'll do. It looks like you're there, Hasra, don't worry. Let me just move it so it's underneath the frame, and then we'll be absolutely dead on. Above that one, where is Hasra? There you go. Okay then. Yeah, so we've had a bit of technical difficulties, but we are now here. We've got muscle pickles at the top because he hasn't paid his internet bills, so he's just having to talk. And Medivac had a weird thing with his webcam that could only be described as that scene in Star Wars when R2-D2 plays back the clip of Princess Leia, that it was just like that. He was moving all over the place.
Help me, I'm behind you, man. Yeah,
as if he was being hacked. Anyway, so I put a quick picture up of Hasra Muscle Pickles, so we're ready to go. I just hope nobody sound goes, because otherwise it's going to be one of those awful text adventures where everybody just types things. Before we get started, I'll give you a brief synopsis and I'll allow players the opportunity to say who they are and who they will be playing. And we start, as ever, with Muscle Pickles. Go for it.
I am Muscle Pickles, and maybe you can hear me, maybe you can't.
Yes, we can.
But I play... We can. Yeah. Oh, good. Good. I play Barlaby Fumus in this group. He is our team's theist. He serves Amriel, the light moon goddess. And through her, he's able to work various miracles and perform prayers that help people. It's mostly all things revolving around relieving fatigue, which is a big element of Mithras, I've found. Healing people, putting arms back on, trying to keep people calm, give weapons boosts in the name of my holy goddess, and all sorts of things like that. Barlaby is not much of a combatant. He can bring up a shield of his goddess that protects him, but when it comes to actually inflicting pain and damage, Barlaby is not the guy to do that. Beyond his theist abilities, he has a lot of knowledge about different aspects of the area of Lindo that we're in. He's very knowledgeable about the lower area, the impoverished side of Lindo. He's known as the savior of the slums. He is streetwise, got knowledge. He also has the lore of history, the local lands and what's happened, which was more relevant, I think, when half the party wasn't even from this land. But regardless, he also knows a lot about monsters and most recently picked up a little bit of knowledge in poisons. Barlaby wants to be able to identify those poisons so that he can better help Captain Kangaroo's sorcerer character, who's perpetually getting into poison.
What the government says.
And to top it all off, Barlaby is a friend of the guard, so the police often recognize Barlaby and provide a little bit of extra help. And with that,
Medivac, it came back on and it looked all right. It was a bit dark in the background, but so I don't know if you had changed something. Before you pass it on, Mr. Pickles, I just wanted to say that Bartleby's combat prowess is reflected in the initiative order that I just saw that is still up on the screen. So like 18, 15, 14, 14, 2. Were you surprised?
Yeah, I got surprised there. But Bartleby is always rolling the lowest initiative. His lowest characteristic is dexterity. He's clumsy. He's got mangled hands. And he's always thinking about his goddess. So I like to think that he's more surprised than the other party members perpetually, because he's often thinking about scripture or things to say, and others are actually watching for danger.
Got ya. Okay, who are you passing
it to? I'm passing it to Medivac.
Thank you, as I clatter away with my stuff. Hi, everybody. I'm Medivac, and I play Hazvikan. He is a nomad from the northern steppes of this continent, Odess. He's travelled down to the city of Lindo to help people, and on his ventures, he's done various things. But he joined this group. He favours a short spear and a scimitar. He's very good at throwing and very good at doing jabby-jabby. He's amazing out in the wilderness. He's your best friend to be with when you're out going through forests and whatnot and looking for food and foraging and tracking. He's very, very good. In cities, not so. Yeah. He's done at home in cities, but he does. He perseveres. He's getting better. He's got a friend, Basil, who he takes meat to eat at the Hairy Hobgoblin, which is where we are currently at. He likes to call Basil a friend. He helps him out whenever he can. And again, he's fallen in with this lovely group of people. Some have gone away, and we now have
Cyrus.
all I can think of is Captain Kangaroo. Ulrich is a new member.
Yeah.
And he's looking forward to learn more about Ulrich and Cyrus. He's getting to know, and he's hoping to change a little bit, because he likes Cyrus, and he really does like Cyrus, and he wants him to just be a bit more accepting of certain things and not too aggressive when he's doing things, but he understands that's part of who he is and his order. And with that, I shall pass on to Captain Kangaroo.
Everybody, I'm Captain Kangaroo. I am playing Cyrus Alias. He is the fun sorcerer of the group. He's kind of like everyone's trying to become a small light breeze, and he's the category 4 hurricane of just unneeded drama. He's there really just kind of like spice things up and make it difficult for everyone to do everything easy. He is able to handle himself not only with magic but also with a little bit of combat prowess, but we're slowly kind of dwindling out who he is and what his intentions are with like his goals in the order goals as a whole. And I think especially with our current adventure, we're going to delve really further into why he thinks he should continue going the route he is, or maybe even consider doing something else as a sorcerer. From there, I'm going to pass the mic over to our GM, in Wills.
please do tell me if you're planning on switching an order or something like that.
Well, yeah, I don't know. Maybe we can work it out in roleplay. I don't know.
Ulrich is a new member of the party. He takes over the tanking role. The players know, or the characters as well, know very little about Ulrich. Or they know that he is clad out in very heavy armor. He fights with an axe and a shield. And frequently when he goes into combat, he utters some alien words that actually helps him while he's in combat. He's also been seen crouched over, giving some kind of last rites, similar to Bartleby over dead bodies. He's quiet. He keeps himself to himself. And as he introduced himself to the party, his master has sent him to learn from the group. And that's about all they know at the moment. So last week we started off, the week before we started off with a new adventure. And the adventure found us all sat in the Hairy Hobgoblin when some of Cyrus's order arrived. Cyrus is a member of the red-robed sorcerers, the Order of the Phoenix, and an initiator, a young lad, came in looking for Cyrus and was promptly followed by Goshawk, who is Cyrus's mentor. Things then went slightly afray. What basically has happened is that Melanie, who was in the Blue Order, the Order of the Kraken, who Cyrus convinced to leave that order and to join his order. She then, the Red Order, found that Melanie had significant power reserves, and she suddenly found herself above the rank of Cyrus. However, she's done something that is not very nice at all. She was in consultation with the head mage of the order, and along with a friend, she has stolen the order spell book. Now, the spell book has all the possible spells that mages or sorcerers of the Red Order can learn. Obviously, they don't need those spells. They all know them. However, it's very symbolic, and plus it's given Melanie access to higher level spells that she does not know. Goshawk presented it to Cyrus that it would be a good idea and put him in great favour with the Order if himself and his group and party, his people who he, I think I'm right in thinking that constantly sort of like refer to almost as his comrade servant like people, as did Goshawk. Then a young lad came in, and Cyrus found out that Goshawk had sent a group of children to follow Melanie. One arrived back who was seriously injured, bleeding all over the floor, and managed to say that, you know, he had gone into the sewers near some blacksmith. The party dashed over there at full speed and found that there was a scene of carnage and bloodshed, as Goshawk's initiates had been, well, butchered quite nicely, and they were dead by the entrance of the sewer. The party decided to collect some more information. Cyrus turned into a small bird and flew into the order and got the rundown on what was actually happening and what had gone on before. And the party decided to go off. Ulrich and Bartleby went off to see Christoph, who is the owner of the tavern across from the Hairy Hobgoblin. And they got some information there. And yeah, the Hazra had picked up the dying lad from this one and put him upstairs in a bed to look after him. The party all congregated back there, and at that point the door burst open and an assassin came in to try to kill the young mage. The party quickly sprang into action, and it got to the part at the end that the assassin was nearly done to, and I said, you'll be easily to overpower him now and finish the combat. And Hazra Medivac came up with a really good idea in Discord, rather at those points in time when the combat, Bartleby will remember a long and drawn out battle with a centipede in previous assault, like lasted 8 weeks. And Hazra came up with the idea that when we get to that point and I sort of like say, oh yeah, you can easily overpower it, then rather than just bring it to an end, you know, we can create a narrative for the last little bit. So this time I'm going to do that, and we'll bring it to a close like that. The next time it happens, it'll be one of you that who's engaged in combat can decide how it's going to finish. And Hazra, I'm going to nick some of yours from the Discord bit that you put in. So I think what had happened near the end, Ulrich had bashed this assassin and had knocked him back a few meters, and he had fallen up against the wall, slightly dazed and disorientated. And at that time, Hazra, I can imagine with your spear, you sort of like dive in as well. And as he slumps to the floor, the assassin, I see if it's all right with everyone that you do that thing that I've seen you done before, Hazra, when you are threatening, you know, the unworthy, and you put your spear tip at the throat of the assassin. Does that sound?
It does. It I've mellowed since I've been in Lindo. Normally it would go straight through the neck.
But, yeah, but you're learning to
sound on that.
Yeah, you're learning to stop at the right time.
That's right.
So the assassin slumps down. You notice that he drops his weapon from the disorientation, and he slumps down on the wall. And Hazra, you go in and maybe looking as if you're about to pierce him through the neck, but just stopping at the last moment, maybe just nicking the skin at his throat, which causes a small rivulet of blood to run down. Darth has just come back and said, "Hurrah, Mr. Pickle's gun show is back." And Medivac is a picture as well, Darth. Hang on, we don't need a picture.
Camera's on. I've got a black screen on mine, so I've no idea. But I can see myself now when I'm talking. I can see myself.
You are fine. Picture,
but my little block at the top has got nothing.
Yeah, well,
looks like you're no longer being hacked by 90s hackers.
You are absolutely fantastic. Darth just said, "I just thought Medivac was concentrating really hard."
That's fair.
Which picture was it, the Game of Thrones one?
Yeah,
and I was constipated. It was a long Game of Thrones.
Okay, yeah, so Hazra, you can pick it up from there since you've got the spear to the throat. I think, Cyrus, you had some spells operating, and Bartleby, you suddenly just come round thinking, oh, what's happened here from surprise? Just to remind you that Bartleby and Ulrich and Cyrus, your magic points won't have refreshed. Because we haven't had a rest since the last time, but everybody's luck points will have replenished. And if you are watching the stream and would like to possibly give the party some nice rolls, then the card pack is available now on Stream Loot, so you can buy the cards and help the players as we go along. So yeah, Hazra, we'll come straight across to you if that's all right. Now I can't hear you at all. I can't hear you. Are you all doing it now? Do you know, it was when Mr. Pickle started to do it, then I gathered.
Got it.
So spear pointed at this assassin. Hazra is going to lean forward, put in, as you say, a little bit of weight on it, just so it pierces the skin so slightly. And I want to say to him, "Who sent you? Who are you working for?"
Okay, and at this point, I would like you I'm just calling up my sheet here. I would like you to make for me a brawn roll. It will be at a hard rating because you don't know what's coming.
I don't like this.
I don't like things like that, where I don't see what's coming.
Do I give him do you know what? Now he doesn't know what's coming. He doesn't know what's
okay, coming. Okay, so you sort of like bring him back and you utter your...
That's fine, no, I'm not going to.
Your words of threatening behaviour, sort of like, "Who taught you, so-so-so-so." And without much warning, the... assassin gets his hands, moves it quickly, holding onto your spear. And just as you see that happen, you try to decide at the quick moment what to actually do. And quite unexpectedly, the assassin holding on to the spear finishes the job off and pulls the spear towards him, the blade of it going into his throat. And as the blood sort of like pops up into his mouth in bubbles and dribbles down from your throat, he has what can only be classed as an evil grin on his face, and quite strangely, he doesn't close his eyes at all. He just stares quite blankly into yours as his lifeblood slowly drains out of him. At that point, Bartleby comes round.
What's going on, guys?
I'm going to turn my head away and say, I hate fanatics.
But Bartleby, you look round and Hazra's got his spear in this guy's throat.
That's going to look so bad.
Hazra.
It wasn't me. It was a one-armed man.
You want a really close shave.
I ventilated him.
Oh, bummer. All right. I want to see if I can approach the body, maybe help search. I think could I roll perception to see if I perceive what actually happened there?
You could. You were aware. You and Ulrich saw it. Would only probably be Bartleby that wouldn't see it, mainly because you all in close range of the assassin. So he was probably peering through somebody's legs. But yeah, you can. I'm going to give you two options. Okay. Ooh. You can either just search his body, or you can search his body with a perception roll.
I want the better. And I'm not going to give us anything interesting if we don't roll anything.
Okay, then. So roll away.
I'm going to have to roll. Yeah. That'd be probably. Oh, darn it. I don't have my church yet. Damn it.
Shame.
Don't judge me. Don't judge me, y'all.
No judgment, just shame.
I'm not. I'm not annoyed. I'm just very disappointed. That's all.
Guys. All right. Hold. P for perception. And here we go.
You can use a point of luck if you wish.
No, I messed up, I guess.
Okay, so you start searching him and, you know, going through his robes. He seems to have various blades, and there seems to be a small glass vial that you see fish out of one of his pockets. But what the perception roll was to see is whether or not you noticed that on one of his pockets there's actually a thin, rather narrow pin / needle. And as you put your hand into the pocket, it just gently inserts the tip of its blade into the palm of your hand. And you suddenly sort of like feel it go in, and you quickly bring it out. It looks like it's a very small, but quite not incredibly deep, but definitely it's not the scratch the skin. The actual blade is only about, you know, 5 centimeters, 6 centimeters long. It looks very much like a hairpin. It seems to be long and thin, but it seems to have some kind of flat area at the end of it that would be used to hold. You sort of like see in your hand at the moment. You can pull it out if you wish.
Yeah, I'm going to pull it out.
Yeah. Okay. So you pull it out, and you notice that as you pull it out, it's a bit what can only be described as sticky. It sort of like tugs a little bit at your skin as you pull it away, but it doesn't. There's nothing. You know, it just sort of like stretches the skin out as you pull it out, and then it goes. Pfft, and you notice as you pull it out that it's got a bit of blood on it, your blood. But the other thing that you notice on it is that there seems to be some kind of what looks like black treacle on the blade.
Great. Cyrus is going to die slowly, everybody. Oh, no. I'm probably actually going to approach Bartleby.
What?
Yeah. I'm gonna look at him with the. Can I pick up the blade in the non?
Yeah.
Stick in my hand. Way. Okay. I'm not just gonna like. Okay. I'll stick myself so I can show you. No. I pick it up and I was wondering. I'm gonna push Bartleby. I feel like this is just a regular blade. I think I just messed up somehow.
Cyrus, would you like odds or evens?
I'm going to go with odd.
Odd. Okay, just roll a 1d6 then.
Ooh, buddy. 1d6.
It's because you never know whether you chose right. No, it's odd a winner.
Yeah, so odd allows you to decide which hand it's been stabbed into. Evens, I would have tried, and I would have said you're right.
Say the assassin's hand.
I would say my left.
Okay, so it's in your. It actually went into your left hand.
Okay. So left hand.
So yeah, you go over to Bartleby. Just while you're doing that, Hasra, is there anything that you want to do? You've noticed that Hasra, Cyrus has frisked this guy down. What did you do with the small glass vial, Cyrus, that you found?
I'm also going to show it to Bartleby because he might have a little bit of knowledge now.
Yeah, got poisons. You. Hazard, is there anything that you would like to do just as Cyrus frisks down and then goes off to see Bartleby? Is there anything you would like to do?
First, the boy's upstairs, isn't he?
Yeah, the boy is behind you in the room. So,
oh, sorry.
Yeah, so you've sort of like, you fought, the door opened, you fought in the doorway, and then pushed this guy out into the corridor. Well, Ulrich bashed him back there, yeah.
Sorry, it threw me off the arm, sitting at the dinner table. Yes, so how's the first reaction again, we'll just to go to the window again and look at the make sure the boy's okay. But he's also, from the corner of his eye, I'm assuming I've seen that Cyrus has been frisking this guy and then pulled his hand away quite fast. Mm. So I'd like to say, as he walks away, Dennis, are you okay?
I'm fine right now, but I feel like I just got stabbed by something that's not just an accidental needle. Confident this is some sort of, maybe some sort of needle that, gives some sort of like ichor or some poison. So I need to make sure I'm safe. Continue, but be careful on the search. I'm going to see what Bartleby can do here.
My friend, I'm going to speak to the boy, but would you like me to have a quick look at it myself and see if I can...
I just hand over my hand and needle. Fix me.
No, I want to try to see what this black ichor that he described that's on there. I tried to like use my survival skill, perhaps.
Before you do that, did you say that you looked out the window?
Yes, I was going to look out the window. Make sure.
So, can you just roll a perception check for that bit, and then we'll do the survival for the black treacle. So as you look out the window, it does seem that this is probably how the assassin got in. It looks like he de-latched the window. And as you look over out the, you're looking out onto the street outside the Hairy Hobgoblin. So opposite is Christoph's abode. And off to the right, as you look down, just as a little side alleyway, just on the corner of it, there seems to be somebody looking up at the window. And as you appear there, or in the shadow of it, looking around, you sort of like look across. He's cowled, so you can't see his face. From his clothes, it looks definitely to be male. And you almost feel as if there's an exchange of eye contact, even though you can't see his eyes. And you obviously see him, and he sees you. And with a very vague flourish, he sort of like flips his cloak round and disappears down the alleyway. If you wish to pursue, you can do, but you'll need to be quick if you want to get down there. Unless you want to jump out the window, of course.
No, attempting and as
just remember what happened.
That would be.
Just remember when you were at the on the roof last time.
Yeah. So, right. No, I'm not going to pursue because my primary concern is making sure this boy's safe, Cyrus and Bartleby are safe.
Okay, so do your survival skill to look at this black ichor, and then you can go in and check on the boy who's on the bed. Yeah, you look at this and it doesn't look...
You've got no chance, mate.
Just comes up to you, Cyrus, and says, "Can I have your shoes, please? Can I have your
boots?" Don't make any long term.
I don't think they'll fit.
That's true. Hazra, there's two things that you can tell straight away. You can tell that this is not natural. It doesn't look like it's a natural venom or anything that would come from a plant. It looks too thick to be that. The other thing that you can notice is that it's obviously been designed to stick to the needle, the small blade, and it reminds you of stories that you might have used, or arrows that you might use, or spears that you might use when poison is attached to the blade and then thrown into the animal. So it's not actually the blow that does the damage or kills the beast, it's the actual poison. The other thing that you do notice, by the way, is that the assassin appears to be wearing quite thick, heavy black gloves.
I'll relay that all to Cyrus and say, yes, Lieutenant Gussie Bartleby. I don't know what part of poison it is, but it's designed to kill.
All right. So please, Gussie Bartleby. I'm going to approach Bartleby.
Cyrus takes two steps and drops down.
No!
Sorry, you took too long. That's okay.
Come to me, Bartleby!
Bartleby, yeah, Cyrus is coming up to you. What would you like to say to him, Cyrus?
I made ouchie.
I know. I've been like 3 feet away from you this entire time.
I don't know. I'm just worried because I personally like to have both of my hands, and I don't want this hand falling off. Can you help me out with your, magic?
Well, Cyrus, I've actually been spending quite a few hours in the Church of Amriel's libraries.
Why, Bartleby's sounding so patronizing tonight.
As you tell the story, I'm slowly dying out of just boredom. Oh, you want reading somewhere, you goddamn nerd.
I mean, you too know the joy of reading and learning more about your order, don't you?
Low blow, low blow.
Now, let's take a close look at whatever this poison is. Keep it in your hands, actually. I don't want to touch it. That looks gross.
I can't figure out whether or not Bartleby is just in a bad mood or he's still annoyed about what happened in the last adventure. And the disregard to human life that Goshawk had.
Oh, and Cyrus is just such a powerful sorcerer that I'm sure he has time for me to look at this and analyze. Could I use my healing or my lore poison skill to help make a diagnosis?
Well, let's do it twofold. Number one, let's roll your lore poison first. Just to let you know, how successful you are with this will be influencing your... healing roll. Okay. So a critical success would be quite nice at this point.
Do that, bro. Just like do really quick, just like knock out a crit. Come on.
I'm just remembering, you know, all of the four poisons I've learned about. Here is the roll.
I have this. Can I give him my luck points?
I guess I could use a luck point here, Bartleby thinks to himself. I would like to use a luck point to make that.
Oh my god, yes!
Okay.
What, you think I'm actually going to let you die?
I'll just come back meaner. I'll come back as a really mean lich. I'm going to be really sarcastic, pessimist.
Okay, so you look at this wound and the poison, and it reminds you of one of the four poisons that you've actually been looking at, which is quite convenient. It is a chemically brewed poison. It's not natural at all. And you looked at poisons from animals, plants, nature, and alchemy, basically. And so it seems to be some kind of poison that has a manufactured state to it. By the viscosity of it, you feel that it must be quite potent.
Great.
And you see, Cyrus, I was reading that this actually was used to assassinate a duchess about 32 years ago, I think.
And at that
maybe that's
point,
the other one.
At that point, Cyrus, could you make an endurance check for me, please?
Hmm. So I can make it through this conversation?
Yeah.
That'd be willpower, guys.
Oh, okay. Endurance.
Begins with an F.
You're not that large, but I made it somehow.
Yeah, and Bartleby, as you're sort of like telling Cyrus this, you suddenly notice that Cyrus is swaying somewhat. His eyes are getting quite glazed over, and he seems to be losing consciousness, if anything else. What would you like to do, Bartleby?
I guess at this point, I'll stop talking about a duchess that was assassinated and call upon my goddess to rid him of his mistakes.
Okay.
Using the rid mistake miracle. Did that not? Here we are.
Yeah.
And here is my exhort. I thought that was going to be a 98 for a second.
that would have been nice. So you called down the power of Amriel. So tell me what would it look like as it hits Cyrus's hand?
It actually looks a lot more like Barlaby's doing theatrics more than anything, as he just raises his right hand to the sky and calls on Amriel to help, but you don't really see anything until Barlaby puts his hand on Cyrus's forehead, his mangled hand on Cyrus's non-mangled forehead. And then it's just like a very faint, a very sudden flash of light. And then maybe some of this dark oozing poison comes out of his mouth or something.
Yeah. Or yeah, it's all like oozes backwards out of the wound, and that's it. So Cyrus, can you roll a 1d4 for me, please?
Ooh, this is also scary.
That's a nice amount, thank you. So just to let you know, you have been cured of the poison, but you will be at an exhausted state for the next 4 hours. So all your skill rolls will be formidable, your movement will be halved. You're -4 to your initiative. -4 to you, your initiative, and you lose 1 action point. Okay, until the 4 hours have gone up, you do feel rather faint and drained, and there's probably a chair in the room that you can slump down on. And every time you look at your palm of your hand, you still see little bits of this black ichor sort of like coming out. And every time you wipe it away, it's definitely a bit like a almost like a pimple being squeezed, a little bit more comes out.
Delicious.
Yeah, Hazri, you come into the room. The boy still seems to be completely safe. He's on the bed. He's still unconscious, but he's definitely safe. Over to you as the group. Cyrus, you can talk, you can engage, but you're probably a little bit out of breath now and again, but Bartleby has definitely saved you.
Definitely. Yay. Probably. You might still die, Cyrus.
I'm going to haunt you. Definitely going to play second fiddle then for next few hours. So what will the plan be, everybody?
Aren't we at about midnight or so?
Yeah.
So, I mean, what I suggest is maybe we all stay in this room. I mean, Cyrus here knows this room really well because he was in here when he was doing his thing where he's changed with somebody else. So yes, if we stay here, the boy's there, maybe we could get Basil to bring some pallets up for us to sleep on and to keep a watch. It's a nice safe place. We'll only want exit and entrance.
Okay.
It's not as safe as my church, though. Oh.
Sorry, we all can't afford to stay in the giant gold rooms of your church.
We could, but would you want to risk carrying this boy across the city at this time of night? And if these people are from who we think they are from, or this person here, and night is their playground.
Night is my playground. This is the optimal time to be praying to Amriel. I can assure you that at least a third of my church is likely awake, though mostly initiates.
Well, yeah, I guess it is the moon church, right? That's when they
that's right. That's right, Cyrus. You're learning.
Just so you know, Cyrus, miracles can be reversed.
Well, here's one thing we should also consider, because I don't think we rarely ever consider. What are we going to do with this dead body that's just, like, right next to us? We're just gonna like, let's take a nap, guys, and there's a fucking rotting corpse right next to
it. It's hardly rotting this quick, but it's
yeah, but
it's not rotting yet, but
yeah. By the time we wake up, rigor mortis will definitely be set in.
Yes.
My memory would be if Basil puts you in the morning.
All we do is just smell like just shitty underpants. What's the plan, Stans?
To do with the body or to do with the next steps?
I personally think, and I will say, Bartley, my friend, could you not call your guard friends to maybe explain the situation here and see if they can take control of this situation? Mm-hmm. And then maybe they could escort us to the church.
I don't know if there's that many patrols at night.
There are patrols at night, just not that many. But you can go down to the street and see whether or not any are passing by. Or you can, sorry, to see Mr. Pickles.
Murder my fowl!
I can see the picture from the bottom of the well now, so that makes sense to me.
I think I'll go out and see if I can. I was thinking of Lower Lindo, where there are no patrols at night. I know. I'll make my way down the stairs and see if I can't find any guards on the street.
So roll your passion friends of the guards. Ooh, nice. Really high roll, dead on the cap there, which is fantastic. So what we'll say is that just as you go outside, a critical would be that they were actually passing through the door, passing by as you went out. But that is a good roll. And, you know, minutes or stood at Basil's doorway, you notice some guards coming down. And Basil is sort of like talking to you, Bartleby, and saying, "Oh, excuse me, Mr. Bartleby, I heard a bit of rumpus upstairs. Is everything okay?"
"Well, everything is all right now. It seems that somebody tried to come in and murder Hazra."
"Murder my friend Hazra?"
"Yeah, I don't know what Hazra's gotten himself involved with, but they seem to be going for him, and they almost got Cyrus instead, I should say. Cyrus is still alive."
"Oh, yeah. Well, yeah.
He might be alive, but the situation is we've left a nasty stain on your fine floors up there, and we need to..."
"I hope it's not blood," he says. "I've had to rearrange the furniture 3 times to cover wood in the floorboards."
"Yeah, it's blood, and it's in the hall where there's no furniture,
and it's leaking.
Maybe Cyrus can do one of his sorcerer magics and clean it up. Is Hazra all right, Bartleby?"
"Oh yeah, Hazra's fine. It's more of the person coming after Hazra that isn't fine. They're dead on the floor. That's why I'm here, and I'm trying to see if I can't spot a guard coming from either of these."
You see one coming down and attract their attention, and Basil says, "Oh, I better go and check on." And as you're talking to the guards and Bartleby, Basil comes up and Hazra, you and Ulrich and Cyrus, you hear him. He's not the lightest of men coming up creaky stairs. And then you sort of like hear him say, "Oh, Amriel, what on earth is this?" And he sort of like comes to the doorway or knocks and enters. And he seems to be really keen, Hazra, to make sure you're all right. And he sort of like says, "Oh, are you all right, Hazra? You're not injured, are you?"
"You've seen Basil come to the door. We'll take a step forward and give him a hearty handshake and say, 'No, my friend, I'm fine. It was just this person came into the building trying to, well, I don't know, he seemed to be trying to kill the boy, I think, but maybe we got in the way.
Killing a young lad, that don't sound good to me, Mr. Hazra. Really does not sound good to me."
No, it's very strange. I mean, I'm so glad that I happen to be here with, you know, with my friends.
Do you have a passion for, don't take this the wrong way, do you have a passion for Basil?
Well, I do. No, I don't. I'm a friend of the Triads, but...
I think a passion with Basil is probably long overdue, since you do technically work for him and, you know...
I provide him with meats to eat.
Yeah, you provide him with meat every now and again. So you've probably got a very secure relationship going on there. So,
we did get about a financial difficulty.
Yeah. So
many times. Like, this should be our bar, but whatever. It's fine.
If you write down that you've got a passion for Basil, or it's probably to do with him, not necessarily the bar.
Exactly. It's more loyalty.
Yeah.
Be a good friend to us.
It'll be 30% plus your power and then Basil's charisma, which is 9. He is a barkeeper, so he must have some. So 30 plus your power and then add 9. And then you can just roll it now.
My key's really loud.
Say again, sorry?
My key's really loud.
Your T's?
Keys.
No.
Why would your keys be loud?
Okay. It's a really good mechanical keyboard.
Oh, I thought you meant keys that locked the door.
No.
What are you sort of like throwing keys into a pot in the middle of the table?
Right. So I'm going to put in 30% plus my power, which is going to be. So it's going to be 37 plus 9, it's going to be 46.
46, yeah. Roll it. Yeah, he sort of like looks at you and he says, well, you know, Mr. Haswell, we're friends, like, you know, we have a very professional relationship. But, you know, if in future, can you maybe not kill people in the corridor?
I understand, Basil. The corridor is a very hard place to hide certain things because you cannot put furniture in here.
I know. Maybe next time there's maybe... throw him out of that window that's open.
Well, Basil, in my defense, I did not intend to kill him.
You killed him?
No, I did not kill him. he killed himself.
Right, yeah, yeah.
Fanatic.
Yeah, Mr. Hazra, and he sort of like winks at you. I know exactly what you mean. He killed himself, don't worry.
With your blade.
Your secret's safe with me, Mr. Hazra, don't you worry. And he said,
"Yeah,
you might need to know something, Mr. Hasra. Mr. Bartleby is calling the guards. So if you want me to be your alibi, then, you know, I'm more than happy to."
Basil, my friend. I'll grab him on both his shoulders. Basil, my friend. It's fine. I asked him to do this because we need to get this body out of your establishment.
Yes, most definitely.
It's not the best place because Bartleby is such a big friend of the guards. He could explain the whole situation to them, and that would be fine.
Yes, Mr. Hazra, I know he will explain it. Don't worry, your secret's safe with me at this point.
The guards come in, it's like, is that the Count's brother on the floor?
So Bartleby brings in the guards and he's very passionate about the guards, and they immediately understand Bartleby that you and maybe not your group would not do something so cold-blooded like this, and they're willing to ensure that the body is taken away and burnt somewhere. And did you say that you want to transfer the boy to Are you going to sleep here, or is the idea to go back to the church?
I think if the guards are here and they can escort us to the church, Hazra thinks that it would be a better place for the boy because there's more healing there.
Got you.
Rather than just us here in a room. No offense to Basil, but my only worry, and this is purely from an outdoorsy thing, is traveling at night can be very dangerous, and those that hunt at night have the advantage.
Yes.
So that's how Hazra looks at it.
Especially when the guards are carrying lanterns.
Yes.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay, then.
And suck at being guards.
Yeah. So don't say that. Sorry. Remember that Bartleby likes the guards. I'm actually missing Mr. Pickle's facial expressions at the moment.
Just imagine me glaring and flexing at the same time.
So they, the guard arranges for the body to be taken away, but also as an escort on some kind of makeshift stretcher to go to the church. And as expected, Bartleby, there are people around, various people being religious and praying, etc. But you manage to find a small room that is probably one of made up for initiates to in the church. You manage to put the lad in there. The only thing that does happen that I have to tell you about is that as you get to the entrance of the church, Ulrich refuses to enter and does say that he will remain outside on guard for the rest of the night or morning, how it is. And
makes sense.
When queried and sort of like, you know, why Ulrich, he just says that he grew up in a very religious family, and he really doesn't agree with churches and religions and gods and goddesses.
You can just say he has PTSD with, you know, the little priest. That's all.
Yeah.
is this a smoke rising off his hand as he touches the door handle?
Yeah. No, he doesn't even touch the door handle. He doesn't even come up the steps.
His feet are steaming.
So he sort of like leaves you there. And I think this would be a good time. I will be assuming that you all have enough rest to replenish magic points, but it'll be also a really good time for you just to have a discussion between the three of you. What might be your next steps the next morning? What is going to be your plan of action?
But before we go to there, I was hoping that while walking with the guards, I could ask them at some point if they had heard anything about problems with the orders, trying to be sort of subtle, like not like saying, yeah, I've heard that there's a book been stolen, you know, from the order that things, just kind of asking something like, I heard that there was some sort of disagreement going on with the orders. Have you guys heard anything?
Are you happy for Cyrus to hear this?
Happy might be too strong a word, but I don't care if he hears.
Okay, then. The guards are... Just roll your influence roll.
Yeah, can do. Influence. 19.
It took such a while, then, for it to pop up on our screen. 19, yeah, they sort of like say things that there's always trouble with the orders, you know, too many sorcerers who are up themselves, etc., etc., pompous and arrogant. And they do at this point turn around to you, Cyrus, and says, no offense, Mr. Cyrus, or no offense, Red Road Magician. And they sort of like talk to you, Bartleby, and they say things like, you know, the sorcerer's orders are not like the church. Everybody working together. Everybody's hungry for power and progression, and they're quite happy to do whatever they want. And they do actually recall when they've had to attend orders. Remember, there's only the blue and the red order in Lindo, and they talk about, you know, having to hopefully to break up fights before spells are hurled at each other. You get the distinct feeling, Bartleby, that they are suffering the orders. They think they're rather pompous, arrogant, big-headed, and think that they, as in the sorcerers, are the most important thing, and don't understand that Count Bastion is actually in charge of Lindo, and they work for Count Bastion. And then you can take from that whatever you wish to.
That makes sense. That's basically all the information I wanted from them there, to see what they know.
Yeah, brilliant. What will be your next steps? I'm going to assume that this will happen at about 10 o'clock the next morning, because you'll all need sleep, even if you take turns and watching, if that's where you want to go. So, so what's going to be the next step? Do you wish to continue the hunt for Melanie, or do you want to bypass that and let it go? Have a chat now.
All right. And Christoph said that this is very important. So I'm inclined to believe that we shouldn't just let this go without giving our fair try. This, you know more about the sorcery orders than I do, Cyrus.
I do, but I don't think it's just, you know, obviously I'm probably, subjective here, but I don't think it's just the fact that it's our special book. There has to be a reason Mel grabbed this book. It means a lot to me, but at the same time, she probably has some sort of, plan, and where she needs the powerful spells or plans to use it for something big. She was pretty successful, being a mediocre mage. So I could only imagine.
One step above Cyrus. Can I just buy that?
because she made her way through the orders pretty fast. That's pretty fast, you know, just doing the thing that we all do. But we have to take this seriously, because I feel like, especially if she has allies with, you know, some sort of dark, you know, assassin league, then she obviously is either she has an employer that's demanding this, or she plans to, you know, use this with this dark brotherhood or whatever it be, to do something. And it's probably not going to be to the benefit of the people of Lindo.
This is my worry, because once these people of the night get involved, and we do think Sniffer has some involvement in this, or I personally do, he will not, he's like a dog with a bone. I remember from last time when he, it's Ryan, he chased me out of my home. If she's taken something and it isn't for her but for him, then it's for an ulterior motive. There may be more to it, or maybe it is a power play, but it seems very strange that this Melanie would do such a brave move without substantial backing. And you've got to ask, what would the Thieves Guild have to do with this? Why would they want this book? And why would they back your young lady?
So we think this is the Thieves Guild that's working with Melanie.
I do. It's strange, but when I looked out the window, there's somebody in the corner of the street looking up the window where I was, and we saw each other, and I think I could I make an insight? Would I? It's a long shot, but would I have known the stance of Sniffer and we've met him before, the mannerisms and the way he swirled his cloak as he walked away in that arrogant way?
Size of his nose.
There should be a button that says blind roll.
Certainly not find that.
Let's
have a look. You have to click your token that's by the augment hit location.
Oh, brilliant. Where's my token gone? It's there. No, it's not me. That's me. And blind roll, yes. Yep.
Okay, so I just need to know what is your insight score?
472 or 29.
29. Do you wish to use a point of luck? I'm not saying whether or not you've succeeded or not.
You know what? I'm blind rolling. I will use a point of luck.
Okay.
I'm really thinking hard about what I've seen through the window, and I'm like, oh, did I misinterpret that? Is that something else? And so, I may read 2 + 3 and make 7, but you know,
the guy seemed to be more bulky than Sniffer and taller as well. Not like overweight bulky, more muscular. Sniffer's quite a small guy, very spindly, his pointy nose, etc. And this definitely wasn't him. And you do get the feeling, Hazard, that if it was him, then you probably think he wouldn't keep hidden. He was at a safe distance, and Sniffer would be Sniffer would definitely be the sort of person that reveals his face, smiles at you, and waves before ducking into the alleyway.
Remembering this and that little look on my face, and maybe it wasn't him. Maybe it was one of his henchmen, perhaps. But
does this assassin seem like? I never met Sniffer. So does this assassin seem like someone that would be employed under Sniffer and his group of baddies?
And Bartleby, roll your streetwise skill. Are you looking?
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Positive? Final answer?
Yes, I do not want to use one.
Okay, the Thieves Guild, although very powerful, do not have bulky. The tavern owners have bouncers. You know, there might be bodyguards of Sniffer, but they wouldn't be thieves with that bulkiness. It doesn't, you know, the thief has to be lithe and dexterous. And from what Hazra is saying to you, it looked too bulky. If anything, it was either a bodyguard or somebody that you haven't met yet.
So what we've gathered so far, we still do not know who Melanie is working with, what group this is. We don't know what she plans to do with the book, where she's at. And we don't know if we were able to find her, if we wouldn't be able to be a match with her, knowing that she has access to all these powerful spells now.
Sorry, did Cyrus say that he wasn't a match for Melanie?
Well, she, you know, has.
I just need to clip this if it's.
So, what should the plan be, guys? I only have one suggestion. I want to see the guy's Sebastian, was it, or
Count Bastion?
No, not Count Bastion. The old fart.
Oh, gosh. Yeah.
Sylvester. McCoon.
Sylvester. Sylvester. I plan to go visit him in the morning.
Yeah, that's a good idea. He always has some interesting answers and some valued compliments on our appearances.
Before you do, again, I'd like to say that this person has attacked us. Similar things happened to us, Cyrus, before you joined us, where Bartleby was attacked at his church, and I was attacked at home, and Angus had something happen to him in the street. But maybe this is a different group because they were very full fronted, whereas this is more subtle.
All right. So we might be dealing with a different group altogether. Do you guys have any other?
I'm thinking back, and it seems very. I'm now starting to second guess myself. I have sniffer on my brain. I'm very sorry, but he gets into my skin. He's an evil man.
Oh.
He tried to kill Brutus.
Yeah, that is true, actually.
That's kind of, how dare he? No, but do you guys know any other, outside of Sniffer and his hooligans, do you guys know any other secret order of assassins?
I don't really interact with those kind of people.
Anything coming to mind? Nothing?
Out of character. In the sewers, when we went on the raft and the big crocodile thing, he tried to eat us, and then we got to the end and there's a mage there.
Yeah, he was a guild master.
He was, right, okay, sorry. And just has it. No, there's nothing comes to mind. I mean, let us see what you make of Sylvester.
Let's visit Sylvester, see if he's able to give me any ideas. Because, yeah, I think that'd be the only option I have right now outside of creating a situation in which we would attract an assassin, and then maybe we can follow that assassin.
Have you met Sylvester before?
Yeah, I met once.
Yeah, I think Sylvester said that Cyrus was almost like Gulliver grown up and thought he had gained height or something like that from being a boy transformed into a man. Okay then, so it's nearly 5:30, so we'll be going for our break in 3 minutes, but I just want to tell you a few things before we go to your break so you can have time to think about it. So the young lad that you, the robed Order of the Phoenix initiate, who's actually in the church now, is still unconscious. Bartleby, they, and Hasra, since you took an interest as well, the church will look after them, look after him. Although he's healed, there seems to be the body has almost like self-comatosed itself, and it's just be a matter of time before he reaches, achieves consciousness again. And then by that time, you know, they will get in touch with you, Bartleby, if you want to question him. The other thing that happens probably while you're eating breakfast in the in the church somewhere or other, and Bartleby's very keen to share the charity of the church, and he probably puts a little offering tray at the end of the table.
Well, I was going to suggest the thing. I was going to whoever the priest was talking to about the boy, I wish to sort of give 30
silver
pieces to, and say, my friend, Bartleby is a very good friend of mine, so please, here, this is for your order.
And the priest or adept puts his hand on your head and says, bless you, my son, bless you, that is so kind. This 30 pieces of silver will be put towards the work of the church and extending Amriel's blessing to all who cometh unto the goddess.
Go to the next painting.
You're very welcome.
Amen.
Bishops.
Yeah. Pardon me, there's pipes.
across the room.
The other thing that as you are finishing off your breakfast and the exchange of coinage, you notice that Goshawk comes in. And he sort of like looks around and then sees you, Cyrus, and almost like makes a beeline for you, and he and we'll play out the whole conversation when we get back. But just to let you know, he says, "We found her, Cyrus. We found her. Well, actually, we found her, as in everyone else apart from you." And we'll leave it there for a quick break, and we'll be about 10-15 minutes. So go off, grab cake and biscuits and probably a well-deserved coffee, and we'll see you back here between 10 and 15 minutes. Okay, look after yourselves and come back real soon. And I'll do that. And we are back. Yeah, we are back with Darth had coffee and a mince pie, and I've just realized, do you have mince pies in America?
No.
Nope. And I got confused last year about what mince pies are.
Yeah, so it's sweet mince, but we have it at Christmas, and I'm resisting buying mince pies until I got my tree up, because otherwise I just eat them constantly.
Well, it's like, as we went to a certain supermarket had Bailey's on a really good offer, so we got some bottles for Christmas, and we do the same thing every year, and they don't make it through the first week of December.
So yeah, I've never had Bailey's. Is that the one that looks like cream?
Yes, it's really nice for the first half the bottle, and then it gets really like sickly.
Is it quite sweet then?
Oh god, it's very thick and sweet, and
it's milky.
That does it. You're not selling it. Can I just? I used to drink port.
Oh yeah.
When I was in, and I really liked it after a meal. Mm. You know, it was really nice, and we're not buying Christmas presents this year in the family. But I always used to buy Chugga Wugga a bottle of port and some cheese.
Yeah.
You know, mainly because when you go around Sainsbury's, they're just on the shelf and you go, yeah, I'll have that. That's present.
Yeah.
Okay, then. Goshawk just comes in to the dining area at church, which probably reminds me a bit of Oliver Twist, Food Glorious Food. There are probably some slum dwellers there that are asking for charity, and the church, of course, has welcomed them in. And in the distance, you can hear the choral arrangement of some morning tide worship going on. And Goshawk sort of like sees you across the dining room or the eating area, and just sort of like makes a beeline towards you, Cyrus. And at one point, he's walking so fast, he doesn't see this young initiate carrying a tray over to his priest. And he literally knocks this this little kid over, and the tray goes clattering, and the child goes down on the floor, and Goshawk just sort of like looks at him, looks at this child and say, "You stupid child, look where you're going," and then makes his way over to the table. And he almost like sits down where he's not welcome. He might even try to push himself in between, say, Bartleby and Cyrus, who are on the same side of the table, and sort of like gets himself in there. And he doesn't seem to talk to you, Hazra, or Bartleby. He sort of like talks directly to Cyrus and says, Cyrus, I have some very important news. We found her.
You found who?
We found Melanie. Well, I didn't actually find her, but yes, shall I say, I am convinced somebody to tell me.
Okay, where'd you find her?
Well, apparently, she's on a boat or ship. Well,
she's on a ship. Is it docked?
Well, it was, but it's not anymore. Well,
so
that's what the information that I managed to extract from the person I met up with.
So the person you met up with said they saw Melanie take off on the boat or ship.
Yes.
As you say. So that means we have no chance of finding her.
Well, I didn't know, but I keep my ears to the ground, both of them, Cyrus. And, of course, it's not just us trying to find Melanie. There are others as well. Anyway, I was listening near a corridor when I heard these young initiates of the wonderful mage, and we really love him to bits. You know, the mage Donald, you must know him. Old, a bit crabby.
You're all old and
well,
crabby.
Well, your passion of the Order of the Phoenix.
I'm passionate about the fifth book, guys.
This is it is an easy roll, so don't worry. You recognize that it's somebody slightly above Goshawk, and so they've got more tiers of people working for them. And Goshawk says, yeah, so I managed to intercept one of Donald's runners. Yes, and they had been down at the pier. And, I mean, Donald, who would have thought Donald could think strategically? I mean, I know it's meant to be in our blood, but, I mean, Donald? I mean, I don't really see how he can get quite lost just going from his room to the dining room and back again.
Gasbag, stop. Slow down. All right. Where is Melanie going?
Yes, so they Donald's initiates were actually down looking for Melanie, like I assume you've been doing all this time. And anyway, they found her boarding a ship, and the ship was bound for Windvine.
Where's Windvine?
Oh, it's up the coast. In a sort of like northeasterly fashion. Yes, it doesn't take long to get there. Anyway, the last thing that he told me before I stopped hitting him was that she wasn't alone.
Who was she with, Goshawk?
Well, it took a few heavy slaps, I must admit, at this point.
Why would they not tell you? Why are you hitting these children?
Well, they I don't think they're children. I think they just initiate. He said he wouldn't tell me. And he said, I am not one of your initiates. I'm not telling you. Well, I soon changed his mind, I tell you. So, pompous little initiate. I mean, who would have thought? Who would have the gall to actually not answer my question the first time?
Goshawk, who was she with?
Oh, yes.
Focus.
A man in black.
That's all you got for me.
And she's on a boat heading to Windvine.
She's on a boat heading somewhere with a guy dressed in black.
Yes, maybe you're right. I should have hit him a bit harder, shouldn't I?
No, you should just get valid, good information. All we know is where she's at, which, you know...
But Cyrus...
We didn't know that this morning, so yes, good on you.
So Cyrus, you know, how do you get information out of people?
I investigate.
I just imagine Bartleby across the table now with his arms folded going,
Exactly. How do you get information, a powerful sorcerer, Cyrus?
Usually intimidation, but yes. I don't need to hit them.
Well,
I intimidate what they think I'm going to do with them.
Yes.
Their imagination's a little stronger than their actual pain.
This initiate, he wasn't going to give me anything apart from, you know, I'm not telling you, you're not in charge of me. I mean, how dare he even speak to me like that?
Do you have any more information? Do you have any intention? Did she look like she had the book with her? Was it just one man in black?
Well, I do know Donald's trying to organize a group of people to go after her now.
Great. And hear me out on this one. What's their plan when they do get there? Just
well, to get all the book. Work? Cyrus, you have to understand how important this is. If you manage to retrieve this book, you will go far. I can imagine the Archmage of the Order probably asking you to visit him himself. You will be within this order, extremely famous, and people will want to encourage you to higher ranks. I mean, I'm not promising anything, but I mean, it is possible that you might miss out a few ranks. I mean, heaven knows, no offense, Mr. Bartleby. No offense, Acolyte. But honestly, I think this has second in command of the order written all over it.
All right. We're going to head that way, I assume. We have a few things before we head that way. Are you coming with us, or are you going to annoy someone else?
Well, no, I am going to report back and see whether or not everybody's been given exclusive access to the, shall we say, crime scene. I'll be going there. I'll send message if I find anything.
Okay. You do that.
Okay, then. So maybe off to Windvine with you. And he sort of like stands up and he turns around to faces you, Cyrus. Well, you know, go for it, Cyrus. This is really your opportunity to be famous. And yes, I don't think it's really right for your servants to be sat at the same table as you. Maybe on a different table, you know.
Goshawk, can you please just leave?
I mean,
I got this.
That religious one, I mean, you know, apparently he fraternizes with the slum people.
I'm gonna slam on the table and hopefully with my aggravation, maybe lighten up some candles around me or something.
Yeah. So just roll your brawn roll.
All right. Oh, that's not gonna be good.
Could be a crit.
Could be. Or it could be embarrassing.
Yeah, you sort of like bang your hand down in. There's a little bit of a hush that goes round. And Cyrus, Goshawk turns around. She said, oh, good move. I saw your servants flinch then. I'm pleased to see you that you keep them under a higher, a strong... leash. Well done.
All right. Anyways, so I'll not look at both Bartleby and Azra. All right. So we're on the same page. Are we going to leave to,
Windvine.
Windvine.
I'll pop it in the chat. So.
Yeah.
Well, since Azra and I are your servants, I don't think that we have a choice here, do we? Powerful sorcerer, Cyrus.
That sounds about right. You're right. All right, let's go then.
Goshawk leaves, and as he leaves, he noticed the young initiate wiping up the floor, and he sort of like just merrily walks straight through it and sort of like looks at him and say, oh, if you were in our order, you would have done it much quicker than that. And sort of like continues in a flourish out of the room.
So I plan to stop by and see Sylvester. Do any of you want to come with me?
Absolutely.
All right.
I will come, but do you think this...
Think this is accurate information?
Yes.
We ought to stop and get some wine first, though, if we're going to go visit Sylvester.
All right.
Bring in the wine.
And I mean some fine red wine.
Yes, a good vintage.
Yeah.
Maybe a case. Cyrus and you can all give me a locale roll to see whether or not you know where Windvine is.
Would I be able to augment with my history lore?
No, there's not a lot that's happened at Windvine. You'll see why in a minute.
Fair point. I think that rolled it.
Yeah, it did.
Yeah, and I really don't know much about Windvine.
No,
I'm the only one with any knowledge of Windvine.
It's probably where you came from.
And Hasra.
Yes, I've wandered many, many towns.
So I'm going to, just going to move you across to a map, and then you'll be able to see where Windvine is. Just 1 second. Okay, so can you see the map?
Okay, yeah, I can, yeah.
Yeah, so you should be able to see Windvine up at the top there, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
The blue is obviously sea. Cool. Down at the bottom here, that is the swamp with the
Brachians.
Yeah. So I think Hasra and Bartleby, you were there. So
we're like another section further down.
Really. Exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. So you traveled sort of like southwest to get to Erwood. So this is going northeast round the coast. You also do know from your locale roles that Windvine initially, can you see up at the top, there's the hills and the mountains, was a town that was based on mining ore and selling ore, the odd rare diamond or ruby, etc. But it is for about 5 to 6 years now, the ores have run out. And so Windvine had to change its purpose. What else could it actually use? And you might see that there's a nice amount of grassland around Windvine. So they turned it into animal products. So they're basically, they raise animals and then slaughter them. And Windvine then carries meat and things like leather, anything that like milk and cheese, any fleeces, anything like that. They sail from Windvine round the coast to Lindo, and then they offload those. Okay, and then sail back with either things that they want or passengers or whatever, in order to make the journey have some kind of refund. Bartleby is going to crack open his finest cellar wine. Yes. So you've got that, and so I've actually got that as a picture, so I'll pop it into World Anvil so you've got a copy of it.
You find the wine, can't we just go to Hengist's place and just pick it out?
Yeah, just nick it.
Yeah.
It's probably all like a slum now, and it's just like nobody's there. You can see Sylvester, which I'm planning on, that you're going to. You want to buy some, do you want to buy it? or
Barlaby doesn't really have any on hand, so I would probably have to buy it.
Okay,
I will give Bartleby some money towards this to buy things. I don't have any need for money.
Okay, then.
I only usually keep 25 silver on me, so that's about my price range plus whatever Hazard's adding.
So how many?
I'll double it.
How many glasses of wine can get out of a normal bottle?
A normal bottle?
I've got a wine glass that takes a whole bottle. One.
How many roughly?
Not normally, what, 2.5? Depends how full you fill it.
Sort of like normal wine glasses full, not sort of like these massive ones that look like bowls.
In normal people, you only fill it so far, whereas in my life...
You fill it right there to the top.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you think 8's a reasonable number?
That seems about right.
Yeah.
Okay. For reasonable size glasses.
Okay, then. So we'll say 8. Do you want cheap wine, reasonable wine, or superior wine?
I'd like to look at the price tag of superior.
Superior wine is 6 silver pieces per glass. So it'd be 48 silver pieces for the wine, for the whole bottle.
Maybe we should go a little bit more expensive, guys. we want to impress him and not give him cheap wine.
Yeah, well, we definitely don't want to give him cheap wine. He won't help us if we do that.
So a cheap bottle of wine would cost 16 silver pieces. A reasonable bottle of wine would cost 32 silver pieces. Superior would be 48 silver pieces. If you want to go to extravagant costs, then it would actually cost you 64 silver pieces.
Ooh,
and that comes in a bottle that is dusty, if that makes sense.
Yes, okay, we want that one.
I want some rarity, some dusty, you know, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I'm going to go up to my chambers at the temple and make sure I have 64 silver coins on me to try and go find this mythical bottle.
Okay, then.
I have coins as well, but I will give you coins. I'll give you 25 coins towards it.
So what good we luck, need to do, we need to get some buying and selling going on here.
I've got my commerce and my lore of poisons.
I didn't decide why you would want. Right, haggling. Here we go. So first things first, you need to roll your commerce skill. So just to let you know, this sets up your roll for the next the buying part of it. So say, for example, you get a critical success on your commerce roll, then it's going to be a very easy roll on your next one. So
gotcha.
Yeah.
Here is my commerce then.
Is it gross?
74 out of 43.
So
honestly,
that would be a fail.
Yeah.
So a fail would just be a standard roll on the next one.
I'm fine with that. I don't think we need to spend any luck on our wine procurement.
So what you need to do now is that you need to roll your commerce again. You're just at a standard roll.
Can do.
Yeah.
Here is my standard commerce.
I'm going to win this, aren't I?
You're going to convince me to pay more, aren't you?
Yeah.
It's a lot of dust, to be fair.
It's going to be 150% of the normal price. So that's 64 plus, what's it? 64. So we're going to add 32 on that. So it's going to
96.
Be 96 silver coins. Thank you very much.
Way to go with your haggling, sir.
Well, see, Cyrus, this is a very... He just said this is a very rare bottle. There's none like this in Lindo. If we want a bottle of wine...
In the back, we're going to find a few more. It's fine, it's fine.
Roll your commas, Cyrus.
All right. I actually have this. A little bit, not too much.
You think Mr. Bartleby has bought the best wine
okay.
ever. Don't forget to put a little tick there for your fumble. But you really do think that Bartleby has bought the best wine possible. It's unbelievable. His haggling skills were off the scale.
Off the chart.
Yeah, you were well impressed. So yeah, you sort of like leave the church, and just so you know, as you go up and get your coinage, and you sort of like walk out the church, and as you walk out the church, there's a group of people bringing in what appears to be an initiate in red robes who is staggering around a bit. And he's got a bit of a bruise on his face, and some of his robes look very dirty, and he looks like he's been in the wars. One arm is cradled to his side as they bring it, and they're sort of like calling for a healer, and other people, but not you, Bartleby, other people are on call, and they sort of like go to him and sort of like look after him and take him in. And as you leave the church, Goshawk seems to be talking to a merchant or somebody he knows, and as you walk past, you just hear him say, "Well, to be quite frank with you, I didn't think the beating would have taken him to the church. I mean, he must be very guilty about something to go to the church to confess for his misdemeanors." I'll just roll a tumbleweed across this.
sorry. No, I'm just making plans out. All right.
And you head off to the wonderful Sylvester McHoon. Are you all going in? That's the first question I need to ask.
We need to be outside first and maybe think of our plan here before we walk inside. Yes. He's a smart person. We always need to be on the same page about who's going to lead, who's got the questions here.
This is basically, Cyrus, just keep your mouth shut.
Typically, yes. Typically, that makes sense. But the last time I worked with him, he actually liked me.
He did.
Because I was snarky back to him. And honestly, I think I should be the one doing the questions. I think this time you guys have to trust me.
It will require an influence role.
That's fine. I understand that.
And you
okay, so you're going to lead this.
I'm leading this, yeah. This is the okay. one I get okay. to lead. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I'll offer the wine, and then you take over. And okay.
Okay, so you...
How's are you coming in, too?
I'm going to push mute.
You're going to do what? You're going to do what, sorry?
Push mute.
yes. Okay, so everyone's going in. And as always, you open the door and there's that faint tinkling of a bell over the top. And as you walk into the cartographer's room, you notice that distinct smell of rusty, musty scrolls and dust and his rather thick, flavoursome tobacco smoke that seems to be hanging in the air. A bit like some inverted fog. And he's drawing something or writing something, as you see in the picture. And he pauses. He stops as you come in and close the door. And he looks up and he says, "Oh, no."
Yeah, we're not really too happy to see your shraggly beard either, but...
Ulrich's not time. Going in, by the way.
Okay.
And I will be.
We have through the door. Before you get too angry with us, we have bought a peace offering, and I aim towards Bartleby and the bottle of wine.
I'll approach and say it's very good to see you again. Put the bottle on his desk.
And it would be even more pleasurable to meet you again if you didn't bring such low quality substances into my house. And he looks around and say, oh, pray tell, where is the man of iron?
You've heard about the man of iron already?
Hengist is at a party, I think.
Party. Yeah, well.
Party, yes.
Probably the best place for him to be, as a matter of fact.
He found a lady, I think, so.
Found a lady or paid for a lady.
A little mixed of both.
I know what the upper classes are like.
Yeah.
Anyway, you have bought me a bottle of something. Pray tell, what may I do for you today?
Look, I'm personally in a conundrum with my order. These people here, of course, have helped me many times. Here's the thing. As you've probably definitely heard, a few nights ago, the main large book of the order, our sacred text, was stolen by a member and sent off. She apparently has had it off with a cloaked figure off elsewhere. My question is to you. She's obviously been trained in the same situation as I have. We all have a definitely similar mindset. And I kind of want to get some outside perspective on why she's stolen the book, what she might be planning with it, and also, if I were to meet her, do I even have a chance?
And what was her name?
Melanie.
Oh, that I did not know. Thank you for telling me. I was aware that there was some commotion about an old dusty book that had various contents in it, but one of your own stole it.
Yeah.
Very typically interesting.
Well, that's why I've come to you, because your knowledge of the mythic arts is an outsider's perspective, and I feel like I need that.
Mythic arts.
Magic.
I am no magician.
But you have knowledge of it.
I have knowledge about almost everything on this world.
Yeah, and that's why I've
approached you. To assume that I had anything less would be, quite ignorant.
Exactly.
So what is your question, Cyrus?
Why would she steal this book?
Oh, I can answer that one quite easily. Power.
Okay.
You know.
Is there any other reason?
There used to be a bluebird named Melanie, a nice little girl, was very content in her order of the Kraken. Yes, I remember her well. She would sometimes deliver messages for me, very prompt and keen and well-motivated. Surely, is this the same Melanie that you speak of?
It's possible. I don't really like to think of everyone and what they've done in the past, but sure, possibly.
Oh, I see. Roll your deceit. Yes, you do be successful, but the 39 beats your 25. Oh. And
bastard.
Yeah. He looks at you and says, you knew her.
It might be, my fault she even joined my order in the first place.
Oh, this is just getting better and better every single moment. Seriously, I need no more wine. So let me get this correct, Cyrus. Mm-hmm. You invited somebody into the order who is now stolen your book and is, shall we say, further up the order than you are.
That may be some information that might be correct. Not all of it.
He looks.
Here's the thing. I'm not coming to you just because I want the book back. I'm coming to you because I feel like the reason the book was taken is not going to benefit anyone here. Or, you know, honestly, I think it's a little bit out of my pay rate to understand why or how, what's the plan with it. But nonetheless, I feel like we need to take it. We need to get it back from her. Otherwise, some bad things are going to happen.
Oh, most definitely. There were more than just spells in that book.
All right. What's in that book?
Well, shall we say there are spells, battle plans, encoded messages. Well, Order of the Phoenix secrets. And just out of interest, Cyrus, if you do come across it and you don't want to give it back to your order, then I would be interested in maybe a possible trade.
Trade for what?
Well, you know, we can decide on that when you have the book in front of me.
I'll consider it, but for now, do you have any idea what kind of secrets might be in that book?
Oh, yes.
What I should look out for?
Oh, yes. Battle plans, strategic understanding, secret communiques between different members of the order, between orders and between orders, and, of course, their relevant leaders, encoded messages. It is actually rumored that in there is the, shall we say, the plan to take over the council.
Okay, so she plans to go above the head of her archmage and possibly
What she plans to do, but whatever it is, it's not good. Actually, it could be quite terrible for your order. I mean, all the Red Order secrets out and about for anyone to, shall we say, collect and gather. Secret passwords. Oh, yes. Now that would be a very interesting thing to have.
I have one more favor to ask.
Oh, a favor.
If and when, favor. And feel free, I'll be, you know, I'll definitely owe you for it. But when I do meet her, or when I do confront her, she's going to know magic that I have not been taught yet.
Oh, most definitely.
Do you have, and anything I have been taught, you know, would not be able to defend myself from these higher magics.
Now,
do you have something I can use outside of, say, my order's powers that I can possibly give me the upper hand in this final confrontation?
An interesting question. I really like this idea that you will owe me a favor. So, yes.
I'll be in debt.
You do have some. That would help you a lot.
And?
Was there anything else you would like to say, Cyrus?
What would that be?
No, nothing. In which case, bon voyage. I hope your trip is, shall we say, uneventful.
Well, thank you. Hopefully enjoy the wine.
Well, it's going to be a struggle. Who actually bought it?
That was me.
He looks at Bartleby and says, and
I think he got a really good deal on it. I think.
Sorry, you sent a religious man to buy wine?
They drink wine every Sunday. What are you talking about?
Well, not that's more of the people who follow Maroth are big fans of wine. Priests and priestesses of Amriel are discouraged from overindulging.
Yes. The wine that they drink is, shall we just say, substandard.
Yeah, they really seem to really big some party goers, them priests of Amriel. Anyways, thank you very much.
Oh, Mr. Cyrus, the pleasure was all mine. And remember, you carry the power with you at all times.
I'll keep that in mind. I'll exit the building.
Nice.
I'll follow as well. And once we're out, Bartleby eagerly wants to share. I think I know what's going on now.
Feel free, because obviously he wasn't.
I'm almost certain of it.
Who's got the squeaky chair?
That's probably me. My chair is very loud. Yeah. But I think I figured it out. It's not the Thieves Guild that's helping her out. It's the Order of the Lich. Because I think a year or so back, I remember hearing that there was attempts from the Order of the Lich to do something with the Order of the Phoenix. I just know that they were trying to get an upper hand, and they are the very stereotyped people who wear the black robes all the time. And maybe they got to her because she's such
Bartleby. I am a spellcaster, but I'm unique in my spellcasting. Well, I'm unique in that I can also fight with a blade. Lich Order of Liches, you will know they've attacked you because they would use magic to kill the people they're trying to kill. They wouldn't use poisoned blades. They wouldn't be using blades at all. So,
well, no, they wouldn't, but they would hire people that would. Possibly, they've got plenty of funds. The black rope person going with Melanie, I believe, is likely an Order of the Lich member who has connections, who can get some assassinations. After all, Hazard was saying that the guy didn't appear to have the build of somebody that would be in the Thieves Guild.
But he's also large, and not even have a build would be a lich.
Hazra and Bartleby, I don't think you were there, Cyrus, when you did the Black Tower. Dark Tower? Was it just Hazra and Bartleby?
It wasn't me.
Gulliver was there as well.
And you remember from that right at the beginning, there was somebody, a Black Road sorcerer, mm-hmm. actually talking to the head of the
in the office. I brought it back.
But there's no Black Order house or accommodation in Linda. The only two is the Order of the Kraken and Order of the Phoenix.
And that Tower on the Sea was literally their order house, wasn't it?
Who's what, sorry?
The Tower in the Sea.
That's the one, order.
Who else would want the secrets of the Order of the Phoenix beyond other sorcerers? It's useless knowledge to Thieves Guild. Well, maybe not useless, but
the purpose could also be just trying to sell it to a high bidder. We don't know yet. I like where your head's at in this situation. I don't necessarily believe Order of Lich would leave such an important artifact, essentially, to paid help. So maybe though.
Did I just interject here and say, how do we know it's paid help? Maybe Melanie herself has turned to this Dark Order and hired these people to help her.
She's already switched once already from one order to another, and it's not going to be much difficult to switch again.
No, exactly. But I don't know that you know your ways or your wiles that you do, but there seems to be a lot of power struggles at the moment. Like,
or always
be like when my chieftain's younger brother wanted to take over, and he gathered many, many friends around him, but in the end he lost. Well, he lost his head, to be fair. But, he lost. But these things do happen. They in the shadows they gather power and then they push on to take over as a bigger entity.
Cyrus and Bartleby, can you roll your associated passion with your order? I think you've both got one.
I do.
Oh!
I'm passionate, I guess.
Ow! But Cyrus...
Actually, you know what? Wait. I'm going to use my point of luck because we're getting to the end here, so...
So I no, you got half an hour yet.
Getting closer to the end.
I remember that my luck points now carry over. All right. You both realize this. You both know that as you progress up your order, as well as demonstrating your prowess in skills and magic, there is also the need to perform a suitable quest to demonstrate your allegiance and your... dedication to the order. And just following on from Bartleby's point of view, then if Melanie had swapped orders, then grabbing this book could be a way of dedicating her and showing how dedicated she is to another order. I'm just throwing that out there. You both would know that.
Okay. All right. Well, the next thing we need to do, we need to find a boat or a ship.
Okay.
Or so I thought it seemed we were going to go by land for some reason.
If she's going by ship, she's going to be there. It's going to be a lot quicker via ship than it is going to be by land.
Be a lot more expensive though too. Hazra is always getting free food on the go.
But maybe we could find a faster way. Maybe Mr. Gulliver's people could maybe and it pains me here, I hate this. Maybe send us there using their water magic. I don't know, Cyrus, if you're able to talk to them and maybe we can bargain or pay for passage, or if there's a way to get to this place, you know, Windvine. But
bargain with who?
The Order of the Kraken.
They're not going to talk to me. They hate my order.
But Bartleby and myself have helped them up many times.
Yeah, that's one of the services that they do. The Order of the Kraken actually gives a lot back to society through their messaging services and their transportation services.
Yeah, they definitely sound like a powerful...
I mean, they're important to order. Society.
Very, very important.
Compared to some other orders. Look,
I don't hate the idea, because I hate the sea and traveling by the sea, so, and it's going to take too long to take Brutus, so I'm going to have to have you guys lead this one, because I don't know if I'd be able to shut my trap on this one.
I wouldn't be comfortable with this, but I've done it a few times, and I know the process and how it works, and this water just envelops you, and before you know it, you're in a completely different place.
And Hazard doesn't like that.
No, you'll see me have a visible little shiver. As I describe it here.
So it might be an opportunity to, rather than only doing one avenue at a time, I wonder whether or not you could split up and some of you
the go... The party?
Yeah, some of you're still in Lindo, don't worry. Okay. There's no assassins around after your blood or anything like that. so... It could be that, and you don't have to, it could be that if you wanted to investigate both, or you either going to the Order of the Kraken and seeing whether or not there's passage to Windvine, well, the other team could talk about down on the docks about passage via a ship, and at the same time, is it possible by land, etc., etc.?
All right. So I think in this case, if we'd split it up, it'd probably be Bartleby, or maybe even also Hazra, talking to the Order of the Kraken, while the other person would come with me to the docks. I'd probably go to the taverns I typically go to in the docks, and maybe I could find a captain there.
Yeah.
Well, why not make it a three-way?
You just wanted to say that.
It's okay when it's in a three-way. How about if Bartleby goes to the Order of the Kraken? because it's a Kraken. Because
I want to take Ulrich then.
Yes.
All right.
They know you, Bartleby. And they know who you are. If Cyrus does the docks, and I'll have a look at the overland.
Okay.
So I go to like a wagon master or the stables. I think there's north of Lindo, there's an exit point, isn't there?
There is at the north end. So going to the guild masters, that would be a valuable place to go to them. If you've got a nice rapport with them, I'm sure they will be able to provide you information.
Is there a role we can make to have a general idea? Okay, how long would it take if we were to go by land versus sea?
I think
a navigation role.
I think that's what you're going to do now,
right? Okay, okay.
Because you're not actually familiar. All you know is that it's up to the northwest, mm-hmm. you know, and so it's a matter of then now working out, you know, each way. So, Bartleby, let's do Order of the Kraken first. So you arrive at the Order, and the Blue Order is really polite. It treats all its initiates really well, as you're aware, really kind to them, even gives them money for doing bluebird jobs. And so I just need to know the information that you're going to give them. What information are you actually going to provide for them? How much are you going to, of what's happened in the past, what are you going to ask for?
I wouldn't be giving that much information. Bartleby would want to tell them mostly that he wants to get some passage for him and his comrades to go to Windvine. And just kind of asking, is there a standard price for this? Is it even possible for your services to bring four individuals to Windvine?
And if they ask, why, are you going to lie?
Bartleby doesn't like lying.
Aren't we tasked by Count Bastion at this point? Didn't he initially set us on our way for this or not? No, he didn't, did he?
It'd still be a lie to involve Count Bastion. He hasn't asked me to do anything here.
They might not ask you the question.
If they do, I would say it's of the utmost importance to me that myself and my comrades are up there.
Okay.
For the greater good. Would you like me to roll a deceit with that, technically, lie?
No, I don't think that's a lie. That's technically true. If you were going to be deceitful, I would have let your deceit augment your influence roll, or the other way around. So yeah, roll's an influence roll for me. Let's see what information you get.
Oh, big money, big money.
They're very nice to see you, Bartleby. They remember fondly when you used to adventure with Gulliver. You might even see Gulliver around, waltzing around somewhere, smiling and feeling very happy with everything. And you ask about passage to Windvine, and they sort of like via portal, and they said that it won't be possible at all. Windvine is quite a rural village. They don't have the prestige of Lindo, so there's actually no portals made in Lindo, in Windvine. So even if they could send you, they can't, because there's no outward place there. Nobody's ever... they tried to convince Gulliver to do it beforehand, but he said he wasn't ready for it. And so, there's no portal there. So even though they said they might have, teleported you up there, it's actually impossible. They can't do it.
Is there anywhere that's closer than Lindo, like a halfway or a quarter of the way up there?
No, the nearest portal would be sort of like northwest of Lindo. That goes over the farmland and the bridge. The farmland, when Bartleby got possessed.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and then somebody kicked me.
Yeah, and over off into the central part of Lindo, where the capital city of Caracas is up there. So Lindo's not the capital. It's a flourishing port.
Huh, okay, that's good to know.
Think about it, that there wasn't a portal to Erwood either.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they're actively trying to get some members to perhaps take on the task to
place portals? Yeah, so they're always asking for towns, villages, not hamlets, to have a Blue Order presence there. So because in doing so, it actually allows them to increase their network of portals.
Yeah, that makes sense. Do you guys know of any other like orders that would be working in Windvine, or is it just one or two sorcerers?
No, as far as they are aware, there's no sorcerers at all. And this is because of how the sorcery works in the campaign. Any body who has a remote amount of magical prowess has to, at age 8, report to an order. And if they don't, then they are classed as a renegade sorcerer and hunted down and encouraged to join an order.
Okay, I see. So they don't expect much of a presence up there.
Not at all.
Okay. Well, I guess that's all the information that I need. I thank them for their hospitality and being forthcoming with all this information.
Okay. Hasra, you've gone to the guild masters, haven't you? And trying to get an idea of what the overland route is to Windvine. What role would you like to do to augment your influence? Is there anything that you would like to augment your influence with?
Have a look. I mean,
are you just, because you're not saying that you want to get there.
I'm just asking the general,
yeah,
what would be the best way to get there,
yeah,
or the quickest way to get there. I mean, I know the lay of the land to the northeast up to a certain point.
Yeah.
But then we'd have to go past round the Baetrakian swamps. So
yeah. So that would, the sort of like the light green is the swamp area.
So I would probably use, I was thinking about locale again, but it wouldn't.
Just roll your influence to start off with, and then we can see because you're not asking really important questions.
And when we say guild masters, we're talking literally, this is what I was aiming at was the wagon masters.
Yeah, that's fine.
Rather than the horrible guild master that I hate.
Yeah, go for it. Well,
yes.
this isn't Minsk. I have to remember that this is not Minsk.
No, this is Hasna walking in the yeah. Please tell me where to go. Oh, that's your first, good first impression.
Yeah, they give you the information, but they seem to be harboring some underlining dislike for you. You're not too sure whether or not they just think you are too common. But they do mention, you should be able to see the map at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, three of the hexes, three or four, depending whether you're in open ocean or not, is like 1 day's sailing. So that would be about half the time, maybe not even half the time. If it's 4 sailing, it's probably just 1 overland. So you can see from the terrain, and there doesn't seem to be any route there. If you remember when you went to Erwood, there was a road. There doesn't seem to be a navigational road between Lindo and Windvine. They do say that the trade that comes in from Windvine, it comes in via ship, and they send things back at ship. So you're not too sure. You know, sort of like here, there's a big forest because that's where you had the fight with the bandits, etc. But you really have no idea what's in the middle here.
That bit there, yes. Yeah.
You know, at all. So it seems like the best way to get to Window is via boat.
Yeah. If you think by boat, it would be 3 turns a day. We don't move that fast as a wagon, do we?
No. And, yeah. I mean, you've been in the swamp before. Getting through that was
slow. Yeah.
Yeah. Which takes us on to Ship Boy.
I beg your pardon.
Ship Boy. why don't you clean my ship, boy?
So no, you wish to locate passage to Windvine. Is that what you want to do?
Yeah, but mostly I'm doing it via kind of going my old routes of my... When I'm going through my drunken endeavors, I usually probably assume... I think what I did before when we're looking for the sea devils. I remember I was having conversations with like a tavern owner.
You actually know a sailing boat as well.
I do, actually.
I think Bartleby actually fixed their ship.
It was a mix of me and him.
I fixed it. Cyrus just gambled.
Yeah. So let's say that you're going to use your commerce skill here.
Okay.
And let's say that your conflict pool is going to be the average of your charisma and power. So add those together and divide by 2 and tell me what your dice pool is.
So 23 divided by 2 would be
12.
12.
Yeah.
12. All right.
Okay, then. So what you need to do is my skill in this is going to... What's your common skill?
36.
36. Okay. So you're going to roll your dice. I'll roll my dice. It's opposed. So whoever wins takes 1d4, 1d6 off the offered person's damage pool. So just put that 12 somewhere. And then let's do some rolling. So let's start off. This is the first roll of it. So if you roll your commerce skill.
Should have done that. Did it show up on your end?
Yeah, it shows me that you failed it. But I won. So let's start off. So you'll take 4 points off your
12.
Yeah. Okay. And then we roll it again. So this is,
come on,
this is you having a discussion with them, and you're slowly getting worse.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So they actually failed theirs as well. So we don't have any negative on that. So okay. Next one.
Come on, baby. No.
I fail mine as well. So roll it again.
Come on. Oh, 38. Damn it. Yes.
So you will do 1d6
nice.
On me.
Come on, baby. Come on. Let's do this. Let's do this. Let's do this. Yay!
So just to let you know, my skill was 30%. My dice pool was 6. So you actually buy yourself passage.
Nice.
There, it's actually at a very reasonable price. The actual coinage doesn't really matter at this point, but you actually won it, so you got a good discount. And there's a ship called the Sea Crest that is heading back to Windvine at high tide tonight, and they're heading up there. And they're taking on passengers, and so they would be quite happy to have all four of you on the boat with them, leading up to them. So that seems to be the best way of your journey up there. Cyrus has actually made organized passage. Please make sure on your character sheets you've got what you would normally carry, and you can take provisions, enough provisions, and the ship will have some provisions as well. High tide's at 5 o'clock tonight. So just quickly, is there anything that anybody wants to do before 5 o'clock?
I'm good to make
the
sure
only thing I would think of doing.
Oh, sorry. Was Hazard talking there? And Cyrus just came in like a red-robed mage.
I generally sometimes cannot hear Hazard. I think the mic, at least on my end. Oh. There we go. Perfect. That's what I need. There we go.
You go first.
No, the only thing I would suggest, you go first. The only one I was suggesting is maybe we should reach out to see if the boy woke up.
The comatose lad. Yeah, okay. And yeah. Bartby, is there anything you would like to do?
Yeah, I mean, I'm going to be going back to the church to let them know that I'm going to be gone for a while, and I'd also be in seeing if the boy was back to a more state. I mean, he's stabilized, but more stable, you know.
Okay.
If he's able to talk.
And Hazra.
I want to make sure there's enough feed and fodder for Brutus. Make sure my bits and pieces are locked down. Tell Basil that I will be away for a while, and I will get some provisions.
I can imagine that you might bring Basil into town. Oh, sorry, Brutus into town and leave him with Basil. You know, because if you're away for weeks, you know, if it's...
Can you imagine if I'm away for not very long and he ends up in a really, really, really big pot?
Yeah. No.
I it's all right, Mr. Azar. I've got him here. Well, most of him. Most of him.
I saw him in a good break.
Yeah. Yeah. You can decide now, in between. I mean,
basically, Brutus is a wild animal. No, he's fine. I can pretty much leave him and he'll wander and come back. You know, so I would leave a big, huge amount of fodder there.
Gotcha.
And, you know, that's my theory anyway.
Okay, so
I thought you stable him.
This is you all sort of like gather your belongings, and you all have things on you and ready for you for your sailing. And you arrive probably about 4:30 and start sort of like get ready to get onto this ship and get yourself settled. And as you approach, you notice that there's a man and a woman at the bottom of the gangplank. And Cyrus, you can see the captain on the gangplank. So you can see the back of these two people. They're both adults, and you can see that the man has got his arm around the woman resting on the shoulder. And as you get closer and closer, you hear that there's a bit of a conversation going on. And the captain said, "I don't care how much you got. You ain't getting on my ship. We've got room, but you don't have enough coinage. You're going to have to stay here." And you can hear the man sort of like say, "But we're, honestly, when we get to Windfire, we have got cash there. Please, please, you can see we are desperate to get Windfire." And you can hear gentle sobs from the woman as the discussion continues.
Obviously, I would like to approach them and then keep walking and say, "Oh, that sucks, bro," and just go back out to the ship.
Well, he spent too much time with Bartleby, I think.
Do you wonder? I just wish I could see Bartleby's face at the moment.
I'm both flexing and glaring.
I'm going to walk up to this group and to the captain. Says, what is the problem? How much are they shot for the passage?
Hasra, as you get up and pass, you do notice that the lady is quite pregnant. She is clutching her hands, almost like you know how women do when they clutch underneath their swollen belly. Yeah, and the guy sort of like turns to you and says, "What question did you ask? How much?"
I was asking how much are you? You're going to Windhelm. How much do you need to get there?
We only have half the amount of the passage, and I told them just to take my wife here, Martha, but Martha will not go, and she sort of like looks up to this guy who you think is probably her husband and says, oh, please, Rod, don't leave me. I don't think I could manage this." And you hear the captain say, "You do realize that is double for women in that condition." They seem to be half the price down.
How much is that, sorry?
How much did... let me have a look.
I'm sure with my friend Hazra and I here, we can pay for the remaining costs as a acolyte of the Church of Amriel. I assume you wouldn't, you are telling the truth that you have the money at Windvine, and
we have it there. So it'll cost.
Sounds convenient.
It will cost something like, well, you're not doing as a slave. It depends how posh you want to do. It's either 15 silver pieces per week or 75 silver pieces per week. You're probably on the 15 per week.
15, definitely.
Yeah. So each of you. So
I live in a hut.
Yeah. With a cow.
What I will say is, I will say to the captain, it's most... what's the bloody word? It's most surprising that my friend, Priest of Amiel, is here today. And if anything does happen to this lady on her journeys, he will be on hand to look after her.
Oh, excellent!
Well,
What's your midwifery like?
I haven't taken any of those classes yet, Hazra. You know this. I told you in private that I thought that I just felt uncomfortable. I don't know the rituals.
Surely it's like bringing a calf out of a trap.
Yeah.
Well, you already know more than I do.
Yeah, you can use your survival skill.
Tie a bit of rope around the neck.
Yeah.
I know about poison.
What do you guys plan to do with Mary and Joseph here?
We're going to pay for their the rest of their
miracle.
Well, the timing is everything in this game. You heard the captain saying, "I'm sorry, there is no room on this boat."
But he just said there was room.
But there's no room at the end.
To be honest, you couldn't plan that for us because we take like 4 weeks to do one session.
Yeah, just to let you know, behind you in the queue is a herd of shepherds and with sheep and three wise men.
Some items on them.
Yeah, you're not too sure. Something about myrrh. I'm not.
And for some reason, they're just an annoying boy with a dumb drum.
Yeah.
Shut up, kid.
So are you going to pay for this couple again?
I've helped people across for Odessa, and I do feel that I have a lot of money now that is just sat there, and I give it to the Brotherhood. But I do like to give. Yes, hell yeah, I'll pay for their passage.
Yeah. Okay then. So
tell me how much I'll deduct it.
Well, Bartleby will probably pay some as well, I would have thought. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah. If your money is at your brother or whatever, we can just hop up to the temple really quick and grab some of my coinage and.
And what about Cyrus?
Cyrus is already on the ship looking for ale.
Good old Cyrus is walking past people in need.
Yeah.
You know, it's brilliant. His character is fantastic.
He knows you guys will take care of it.
You can see where all the nastiness starts off in the order of the Phoenix. Can you all move your characters on the ship?
I cannot.
No.
I can't. I can move Bartleby, but he won't go into the water for some reason.
Oh, hang on.
Why are you touching me? Stop it, Cyrus.
Learn to swim, it won't Bartleby. Work.
My goddess says no drowning.
I'm more worried about.
She controls the waves. If she went drowning, she wouldn't do anything.
Okay. Try now. Water.
She does control the waves because she is.
I got it.
She is the moon goddess. So, the god of the ocean. Well, actually, I'm not going to make any words about god of the ocean. Okay. That's a bad time to be insulting gods.
Yeah. And just before we leave for this week, I think it's a really good time before we set off to see who actually travels by boat well. Now, what I would like you to do is that you're going to make an endurance roll. But this endurance roll at the moment is very easy. Okay? So it's like, it's actually double your skill. That's what a very easy roll is. So if your skill was 16, it's just doubled to 32.
Is because we first set out, it's all exciting, and it's like, oh, this is really nice.
Yeah, yeah. And some of you have been on a boat before.
Yeah.
So just as we set sail, could you all roll your endurance? It'll be a very easy.
Why do I feel like I'm going to shit my britches?
Hasra, you're fine.
I feel so good.
Bartleby!
Wow.
Yeah, Bartleby is actually.
Everybody's stepping now.
Bartleby's at the front of the ship with his hands out doing a Titanic thing.
This is my favorite quote.
Yeah, I'm on top of the world. And, you know, and you're all making conversation and. You know, apparently they were going to call this boat the Titanic, but then changed at the last minute. So that's it. So we'll leave you bobbing along on the waves, heading out towards Windvine. And yeah, of course, I'm going to start the next event, next session, just by saying you are currently at Windvine. I'm sure there's plenty of things. Has anybody ever seen the golden, golden of Sinbad?
Oh yeah, golden yeah. Voyage. Well, I've watched one of them.
Yeah,
Golden Fleece, Golden Voyage. Yeah,
Golden Voyage of Sinbad. Yeah. Yeah, it's our Jason and the Argonauts is the golden.
Yeah.
I love the bit where they take the Hydra teeth and throw it on. And the skeletons come up. So we'll see. The weather currently looks fine. And that
fine.
And just before we go, I just want to say, some of you could come out of this as being real heroes. That's all I'm going to say. And we'll
hear that, Bartleby. Real heroes, not just people who pay people's, you know, bar tab.
So
okay, I was the one who made sure you didn't die minutes ago. Yeah, next time, do you want me to tell another story before I get to the actual healing? Because I can tell stories.
So we will start next week on the ocean waves as we sail to Wing.
Ocean of ears.
Ear. You making fun of my waves?
Yeah.
Right. Thank you very much for coming along and supporting us tonight. Thank you to the players, and thank you to Ulrich. I think you've been very good tonight, Ulrich. I'd just like to say that.
I like how
dark and brooding.
The best played by the best player. Yeah. We will hopefully be back next week at 7 o'clock when we will see what happens on the ocean waves. I will be streaming tomorrow at 11 o'clock with some Stardew Valley, and then 2 o'clock tomorrow afternoon for Elder Scrolls Online. Until then, please make sure that you stay safe, stay healthy, but most importantly, stay positive. And it's goodbye from me, and it's goodbye from them.
Goodbye.
Oh, well done. We got there. Excellent. Let me change it.
Now 10 years in the making.
This video is sponsored by the Design Mechanism, the makers of Mythras. Mythras is a registered trademark of the Design Mechanism, Inc., used with permission, all rights reserved.